Many don't realize this, so they just see dry religious ritual. And even Christians often lose sight of it. But here it is all the same. Christianity is all about Jesus. And today's passage, I think, supremely demonstrates the centrality of the Lord Jesus Christ. Verses 5 to 11 of Philippians 2 are, I would say, some of the most exalted sacred verses in the whole of the Bible. Their poetic nature has led some people to speculate that perhaps they formed part of an early church hymn. Now, we can't say for sure, but they are, beyond any doubt at all about Jesus, about who he is and what he truly did. And they follow his career from eternity past right through to future eternal glory. They're awesome verses. And I think they are an explanation, ultimately, for Paul's statement. They're the reason Paul could say, for me, to live is Christ. But they aren't just here for us to be dazzled by Jesus. Because Paul himself says in verse 5, your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus. Or as the older translation puts it, which some of you may be more familiar with, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. So to these disunited Philippian Christians who were infighting, struggling with pride and selfish ambition, Paul says, look, the mindset of the Lord Jesus is to be your mindset. And that's the challenge for those of us here who are Christians. Christ's example is to be applied, not just appreciated. Yes, we all fall short, but these dazzling verses are a picture of the mindset that must be ours. Humble, self-sacrifice. It's the way of the Christian faith. We're to have the mind of Christ. Now, we're going to examine Christ's career as it's laid out for us here. And it's laid out in three stages. We have his glory in verse 6. And then verses 6 to 8, we see his sacrifice. And then in verses 9 to 11, we see his exaltation. So we're going to start by looking at his glory. Verse 6. Very simply, Jesus was in very nature God. And this tells us straight away that Jesus didn't exist for the first time when he was born in the stable in Bethlehem. He was pre-existent. So in eternity past, he was in very nature, or as the other version says, in the form of God. Now, Paul isn't referring to outward physical shape here, because the Bible says God's a spirit. God doesn't have a body like a man. Paul is speaking of essence, the qualities, the characteristics of God. He's saying that Christ possesses the qualities and characteristics of God. Christ is God. Now it begs the question, who is God? Well, there are a number of things we could say. God is infinite, which means he's without limit. He's beyond human measurement. God is immutable, which is to say he's changeless. He's not subject to decline or old age or fickleness. He never changes. God is omniscient. He knows all things completely and always. God is omnipotent. So he's all powerful. And that means that no one and nothing can thwart him or frustrate him. God is eternal, which means he's without origin. And he's without end. God is omnipresent. He's in all places at all times. God is all-sufficient. He's grounded in himself, and he has no need to depend on anything or anyone else. God is holy, which means he's totally other, totally apart, totally pure. No evil, no sin in him. God is all-wise. He's full of perfect, unchanging wisdom. And God is faithful. He's infinitely, unchangingly true. There's no deceit in him. And God is just. He's infinitely and unchangeably right and perfect in all he does. And he's perfectly loving. He's good. He's kind in everything he says and does and is. Now, I could say a lot more. You can't exhaust the inexhaustible. But that just gives you a tiny glimpse into God's majesty. He's not just a slightly cleverer human being. He's not an old man in a cloud. He's not my mate, there for me when I want him. God is a being of supreme greatness. And I'm so glad he is. I mean, if God were predictable, if God was like me, and changeable and predictable and boring, and he was well within my intellectual capacity to grasp, well, he wouldn't be God. He certainly wouldn't be a God worth trusting with my life. And wonderfully, God isn't like that at all. He's vast. He's far beyond our human comprehension. It says in Job 11, "Can you fathom the mysteries of God? Can you probe the limits of the Almighty? They're higher than the heavens. What can you do? They're deeper than the depths of the grave. What can you know? Their measure is longer than the earth and wider than the sea." Now that's God. And the point of all that is that in eternity past, Jesus Christ was in his nature that God. He was that same awesome, incomprehensible, supreme, eternal being. We're told in the Bible that God is one God in three distinct persons: Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And Christ was the second person of the Trinity. He was God, the eternal Son. He was the agent, the author of creation, equal with God. John 1 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." So Christ possessed all things. He wanted for nothing. He had everything he could ever want or need. The darling of heaven. And if you just even begin to grasp that, you can get just a little sense of the magnitude of Christ's sacrifice. Because Christ did sacrifice. Secondly, in verse 6, Paul says that Christ, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. You know what it means to grasp something? It's to seize hold of it and keep it firmly in your possession. We might speak of a greedy person, and we might say, well, they're grasping because they're always wanting to not only keep hold of their money and their material goods, but if possible, to get more. And often you find that that kind of person, the more they have, the more they fear losing it. They grasp hold of it. And yet Jesus, who had everything, didn't consider his divine nature and his eternal glory something to be held on to at all costs, or to be perhaps exploited for his own self-advantage. Instead, he gave it up. It says he made himself nothing, and it's commonly translated as emptied. Now, my son has a little piggy bank at home, and every time he gets full marks on his spelling test, he gets a pound coin from me and a pound coin from his grandfather, and I think we're going to be out of pocket soon, and we're probably going to have to remortgage the house. But he's very proud of this money that he's built up. He's got a stack of money inside, and he's earned it. It's his. He hasn't got a lot, but he's got that money. Now imagine if he just said one day, "Here's my piggy bank. I'm going to pour it all out. Here you are, Dad. It's yours." Now I can't imagine that ever happening. But if it did, it would be extraordinary. It would be an act of unselfishness and sacrifice and self-giving. And think of Christ, who had everything. And he didn't grasp hold of it. He emptied himself. He poured himself out. Everything that he was, it was an act of self-giving. And just to elaborate what this really meant, look at verses 7 and 8. First of all, it says that Christ was made in human likeness. He was found in appearance as a man. And don't be deceived by the language here. It doesn't mean that Christ only appeared to be human. It means simply that he was clearly recognizable as a real human being. We have a saying, if it waddles like a duck and it quacks like a duck, it's a duck. And anybody who spent any time with Jesus on this earth could tell you straight away, he is a human being. And that was a huge sacrifice. Why? Well, I hate to tell you this, I don't want to burst your bubble, but compared to God, all of us are very, very small. Now, I went on lots of lovely walks during lockdown when the sun was out and it was warm, and enjoyed the countryside around here. But often as I was walking, there'd be a tiny fly. You know those sort of tiny flies that suddenly buzz into your ear? They're really annoying, aren't they? And I would sort of swat it away. And the gulf between God and man is far greater than the gulf between me and that tiny little fly. For Christ to become a man was a vast descent. Remember from whence he'd come. He was outside of time and space. He could be anywhere and everywhere at the same time. Totally unrestricted, and now on earth he had a frail physical body, which meant that he could only be in one place at one time. And like us, he was subject to tiredness, hunger, thirst. He could feel real pain. He could be killed. Charles Wesley put it memorably in his hymn, "Our God contracted to a span, incomprehensibly made man." It was incomprehensible in terms of how it happened, but also incomprehensible emotionally. How could one who was God bear such limitations? It's incomprehensible, but he did bear it. Now, if that wasn't sacrifice enough, consider secondly the kind of human Christ was. He wasn't a king, he wasn't a lord, he didn't have a rank worthy of his greatness. We're told Christ took on the nature of a servant. And the word is actually slave, a more brutal but a more accurate translation. Now, slavery was common in Paul's day. It was built into the Roman economy. It kept society running. It was a fact of life, whatever we may think of it today. Now, some slaves were actually not badly treated. They were like household servants, so to speak, employees. Others were treated very badly. They were abused. But the point is that whether you were treated well or badly, a slave was still a slave. No rights, no authority, no freedom. Your purpose was just to serve your master. That's why you were alive. Serve your master. And Jesus, the king, became a slave. Only a slave with a difference. He was a willing slave. Nobody forced him to do what he did. How could they? He was God. He never stopped being God while he was on this earth. It was self-imposed slavery. Now, I'm sure you've all heard an exasperated parent say to their children, "Well, what did your last slave die of?" And you see, from our earliest years through to adulthood, we all like to be waited on. We all find it hard to serve others. And the Philippian believers were no different. And Paul had to rebuke them. He says early in the chapter, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others." We all find that hard, don't we? Our sort of native human mindset is me first, others second, and not Christ. He wasn't preoccupied with his own needs. He wasn't selfishly seeking all the time to promote himself. He wasn't angling for position. "Well, if I say that to that person, perhaps they'll think well of me." Not at all. He didn't come to be served, but to serve. We see it in his earthly ministry, don't we? He was always doing things for other people, whether it was washing his disciples' feet or healing the sick or driving demons out of people or giving sight to the blind or spending hours of his time preaching to people, being followed around by people, asking him stupid questions. Every part of his life was all about more and more giving to others, pouring himself out. He was a servant. He was a slave. And of course, above all, underpinning it all, he was serving his Father in heaven. He served God. Even though he was co-equal with God, he became, as it were, the Father's servant. You think of us, we're just poxy little human beings, and we ignore God and we say, "Well, my will be done, it's about me." And the king of the universe, who was co-equal with God, he said to God, "Your will be done." Now, as I said, it was willing slavery, which is why the word servant is used here. Jesus was, if you like, a wise steward, worthy of trust, looking after his master's affairs. The Father wasn't forcing him to do it. He was willingly doing it. But slavery it still was. We have to remember that. One writer says, "The only person in the world who has the right to assert his rights waived his rights." That was Jesus. And then to crown it all, thirdly, Christ the pinnacle, the apex of his sacrifice. He humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Now, nowadays, the cross is a common religious symbol. You'll see people maybe in the windscreen of their car, or perhaps a little crucifix around their neck. It's considered perfectly respectable, not in every part of the world, but certainly in the West. But if you wore a cross around your neck in the Roman world, well, people would have looked at you in horror and disgust, and they'd have thought, is he out of his mind? I guess it would be the equivalent of waltzing in here one morning for a service wearing a t-shirt with a swastika on it, or, you know, a picture of Hitler on your shirt. You know, that would be a symbol of evil. And in Paul's day, the cross was a symbol of evil. Crucifixion wasn't the only way people were executed in those days, but it was certainly the worst, the cruelest, the most degrading. It was reserved for non-Roman citizens, and not just non-citizens, but the worst, traitors, barbarians, real lowlifes. So the cross was utter humiliation. It's no wonder Paul says here, even death on a cross. You can almost hear he's incredulous. And Christ hung on that cross, that symbol of suffering and shame. And of course, when he hung on that cross, he died. Human beings die. It's a curse of sin. It's the nature of things for us, but not for God. And without Christ's given consent, death would have had no power over him. He was the eternal, immortal God. And yet Paul says Christ was obedient unto death. He was so submitted to his Father's will, even the indignity of death didn't stop him. It was the Father's will, right back in eternity, that human sin be atoned for. And we ask the question, well, why would that be? Certainly it's nothing to do with us, in that we haven't done anything to make God love us, and God knew we wouldn't. We've all lived without reference to God. We've all rebelled against him. We deserve judgment. We're just creatures. We're not important in the grand scheme of things. But what does that famous verse say? John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. That was why. Because of love. Because God is, as I said at the beginning, pure love. And in love, God provided the means by which sinners can be saved. His Son. And on the cross, Christ, who'd never sinned and was perfect and was God and man, was treated as if he'd sinned in every conceivable way and to every possible extent. He was treated like he was the worst mass murderer and thief and rapist and blasphemer, as if he'd sinned every one of our sins and more. And the full wrath of God against sin was heaped upon Jesus on the cross, so that we needn't receive it. And Christ freely came to earth for that purpose, knowing that was what was going to happen. If you like, he was born as a pig to the slaughter. He was born under sentence of death. He lived every day on this earth with the knowledge that excruciating suffering was going to be where it would all end up. And if that had been me, I would have done everything I could to have avoided it. And he could have done, because he was God. He could have easily swerved the cross and lived in peace and conquered the world and had everyone worshipping him. But Jesus had the humble mind of a servant. He was fully submitted always to the when and the where and the what of his Father's will. And in love, he was obedient, even unto death on a cross. Now, I want you to keep that picture in your mind, that picture of a dying, bloody, beaten man being jeered at and mocked, dying a criminal's death, hanging on a cross. No concern for his own comfort or his own convenience or his dignity. No desire to grasp hold of his heavenly glory. Nothing held back. Everything poured out for our sakes. Keep that picture in your minds. And then remember what Paul has said Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. That was the mindset of Christ as he hung on the cross. And Paul says that is to be our mindset, our attitude of heart and way of life. Now, can you imagine how Euodia and Syntyche felt at this point? Those two feuding women at war with each other in that church. Can you imagine how maybe some of the other Philippian believers must have felt at this point? You can imagine they must have felt at least a bit convicted. Do we have the mind of Christ? They might have asked. Or is our mindset the sort of mind your own business, I'll live how I like kind of mindset? And how about you this morning? How about me? You see, these amazing verses are not here just for us to admire and think, isn't Jesus wonderful, though he is. His example is to be applied, not just appreciated. If we confess him as Lord with our lips, we're to submit to him as Lord in our lives. And that means imitating him. No, we're not required to suffer and die the way Jesus did, because that was once for all. But we are required to die to self, to die to sinful ambition and pride and selfishness and thinking only of myself, and in humility rather consider others as better than ourselves, and to put Christ first. That's the way of Jesus. Now, as we'll see in just a few moments, it ended wonderfully and will end wonderfully for the Lord Jesus. He is exalted. And if we follow him in his suffering and in his attitude, it will end in glory for us too. But here's the thing, not yet. The televangelists and self-help writers of this day will tell you that Christianity, it's all about living your best life now, and health and wealth and prosperity now, and having a big house now. And it's not. In Christianity, the way up is down. Glory comes the way of the cross. It's cross first, and then it's glory. There are no shortcuts. And if you don't believe me, well, look at the life of Jesus. Now let's end by briefly considering the final stage of Jesus' wonderful career. And it's his exaltation. After he died, after he'd been raised from death, Christ ascended into heaven, and at that point, Paul says of Christ, therefore God exalted him to the highest place, the special place of honour in heaven. Now, it wasn't so much Christ's reward, because the highest place was already his by rights. He was equal with God. Rather, we should consider this as God's vindication, the ultimate seal of God's approval. You see, when we think about the cross, even today, there are many, many people, and I've even heard Christians say to me, what a shame, it's so sad that Jesus died, as if it was an accident. And many people at the time thought so, even Jesus' first followers, in the hours and the early days after his death, thought it was a tragedy. And it wasn't, was it? It was planned in advance by God, and it wasn't in vain. Satan thought it was. Satan thought at the time, perhaps this is my moment of triumph. And it wasn't. In bearing God's wrath upon sin, what did Christ do? Well, he smashed sin's power. The sting of sin is death. And what sin does is it lures you in. It looks good, tastes nice, and it hooks you. You're addicted to it. And you carry on. But it's the death of you. And the death of a sinner who has no relationship with God is awful, and it's final. Never-ending death in hell. But Jesus received that death on the cross. He swallowed the sting. And to make it abundantly clear that he'd done this, he rose from death himself, as if to say to death, you've got no more power now. You're not calling the shots anymore. And therefore, no matter how sinful and messed up any of us are, if we look away from ourselves and we only look to Jesus and we only trust in his perfect life and his atoning death, and we ask him to save us, well, sin no longer has any power to send us to hell. Our sins are forgiven in Christ, their condemnation swallowed up by Christ, and we can go to heaven. And when you think about that, that's not a tragedy. That's a miracle. That's God's greatest miracle of grace, that people like you and me can be saved and go to heaven. And if you know yourself, and I know myself, it's an absolutely extraordinary miracle that I'm going to be in heaven one day. And it's Jesus Christ's triumph. And it deserves and it demands the acclaim of heaven and God's vindication and seal of approval. And that's exactly what it's going to get. Christ is rightly exalted today in heaven to the highest place because of what he did. And he's given the name above every name. And there is only one name above every name. Yahweh, the Lord. The name of God himself. And publicly in front of legions of angels, God has bestowed upon Jesus that ultimate, extraordinary honour. His name, the name of God. Jesus Christ is Lord. He is God. And what's more, one day it won't just be God saying this. Because if verse 6 looked back to eternity past, verses 10 and 11 look ahead to something that hasn't happened yet, but will do. One future day, at the end of time, at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth. It's not happening at the moment, is it? But one day it will. And every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So in that day, every single created being, the living and the dead, angels and demons, they will all be compelled to acknowledge that Jesus was not just a good man, he wasn't just a prophet, he was God. He is Lord. And what an extraordinary end to a career, from the degradation of the cross to the whole created order worshipping him as Lord. And how richly it deserved, and how right and proper it is, that the one who held nothing back and poured himself out and only ever obeyed his Father will be the bright sun that everyone looks up to in the new heavens and the new earth, the centre point of creation. That's the end of the story. That's where everything is headed. Now it tells us, I think, what God really values. It tells us the things that receive God's seal of approval and God's vindication. Pride doesn't. We're told that God opposes the proud, and that's in the present tense, so he's opposing the proud every day. But self-giving sacrifice leads to exaltation from God. God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. And this tells us about the direction of travel. This is where everything in our world is headed, whether we realise it or not. One day, when everyone, willingly or otherwise, is going to bow to Jesus and acknowledge him as God. The question is, will you do it willingly now? No one's putting a gun to your head to do it now. Will you submit to the Lord now and confess him as Lord now and bow to him and give your life to him? Or will you wait until you've got no choice in the matter and you have to, along with everybody, bow before the one who's about to judge you and send you to hell? That's the question. Will you confess him now and live his way now and say no to self and yes to Jesus now, knowing that there is glory ahead and it's going to be wonderful and the Lord will be with you in glory forever? Or are you going to live for the fading glory of today? Are you going to live for yourself? Everything depends on this, really. What did Jesus say? He said, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me will find it.